Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Rod Hembry.
I'm Corey.
And I'm Ryan.
This is Quick Study, weekend edition, where we've come together to put the studies together for the whole Bible. And this is very exciting. We're in the book of Isaiah, and we have people here to help you understand and help me understand what's going on. Corey, what's going on?
Today, we're going to be taking a look at some ancient pictures, really. We're going to be taking a look at something called the Lachish Reliefs.
All right, excellent. I look forward to that. Now, Ryan, what did you study today?
Well, I'm excited because today we're talking to a nuclear physicist.
A nuclear physicist? You mean, really?
Yeah.
You worked with
real.
Oh,
yeah.
My goodness. That's incredible. Anyway, that's good. We're looking forward to that. Later on in the teaching segment, I'm going to be talking about this. Jesus Christ brings justice to the Gentiles. Now, what in the world is that all about? Where does he get justice? We'll talk about that and much more coming up in just a moment. So get your Bible guide out and your Bible and let's study.
Prophet Isaiah was alive and active in prophesying during the time period of the Assyrian invasion of Judah. Now, the Assyrian invasion did not successfully take over Jerusalem, but it did take Lachish. The ancient Assyrian city of Nineveh was first excavated in 1846 by English archaeologist Sir Austin Henry Layard. Nineveh was made the capital of the Assyrian Empire by the famous King Sennacherib, whose run-ins with King Hezekiah of Judah are recorded in the Bible. During Layard's excavations, Sennacherib's monumental palace was uncovered. In Sennacherib's records, it is described as the palace without rival. In one section of the palace, a massive series of three straight hallways or portals led to a focal room. Two statues of winged bulls with human heads flanked the entrance to each hallway. Each set of statues was progressively smaller, designed to give the illusion of a much longer walkway. Through these portals was a showroom completely covered with stone carvings of the destruction of the biblical city of Lachish by Sennacherib's army. The grand scale of this display shows just how important and impressive the Judean city of Lachish must have been. Clearly, its destruction was a crowning achievement for the Assyrian king, and Lachish was only the second most important city in Judah, Jerusalem taking first place. The rock carvings on the walls were removed in panels by Layard and transported to the British Museum, where they are today on display. The panels portray vividly the brutal and chaotic destruction of Lachish described in the Bible, in Sennacherib's records, and through the archaeology of Lachish. The first panels show Sennacherib's diverse army of conquered nations marching against the city. The mid panels show the heat of the battle, with seven battering rams moving against its walls and a siege ramp covered in wooden walkways. The final panels reveal the aftermath. Families of Judean captives walking barefoot into exile with their children, soldiers begging for mercy in front of Sennacherib's throne, the torture of Judean soldiers, public display of dead bodies, and the looting of riches from Lachish. This time period in ancient Judah's history is very well documented. Not only do we have three different biblical accounts coming from 2 Kings, 2 Chronicles, and the book of Isaiah, we also have extra biblical documentation. So in a few different ways, we have records that the king of Assyria, Sennacherib, himself had written about a year after the campaign against Jerusalem that's recorded in the Bible three times. He mentions Hezekiah by name and the city of Jerusalem by name as well. And then, of course, this archaeological discovery that we just looked at, how he decorated one of the main areas going into his courtroom with scenes of what he declared to be one of his greatest military achievements, the military destruction and conquering of Judah's second strongest city, Lachish. Now, of course, her first strongest city was Jerusalem, which Sennacherib, agreeing with the Bible, does not claim to have destroyed or taken, only to impose taxes upon, which the Bible also tells us that Hezekiah paid tribute to Sennacherib to try to get him to withdraw his army. So really interesting that we have so much documentation from this time period. A little bit later on in today's program, you and I are going to be taking a look at some of the pagan practices that King Hezekiah and Isaiah tried very effectively to rid Judah of.
Amazingly, God proclaims his works among mankind in a certain way. He is always present even in the bad decisions that man has made and continues to make. God is patient. God is never pushy. He waits for people to hear his message. He speaks to all of us in a deeply personal way. Now, this is God's story and the works of Jesus Christ as written in the book of Isaiah, chapter 42. When the prophet changes mode, he speaks to the future. Isaiah lived in the 8th century BC, but described the works of Jesus Christ in the past 2,000 years. When we hear Isaiah's words, we hear the works of God.
Isaiah 42, verses 1 through 13. Behold, my servant whom I uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the Gentiles. He will not cry out, nor raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and smoking flax he will not quench. He will bring forth justice for truth. He will not fail nor be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands shall wait for his law. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread forth the earth and that which comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness and will hold your hand. I will keep you and give you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the Gentiles, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the prison, those who sit in darkness from the prison house. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to carved images. Behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Sing to the Lord a new song, and his praise from the ends of the earth, you who go down to the sea, and all that is in it, you coastlands, and you inhabitants of them. Let the wilderness and its cities lift up their voice, the villages that Kedar inhabits. Let the inhabitants of Selah sing. Let them shout from the top of the mountains. Let them give glory to the Lord and declare his praise in the coastlands. The Lord shall go forth like a mighty man. He shall stir up his zeal like a man of war. He shall cry out, yes, shout aloud. He shall prevail against his enemies. Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 through 13.
The prophet Isaiah is an amazing prophet who speaks, and God tells the world what he thinks when he speaks. He is touched by the angel. He has been totally and completely transformed by the word of God, which we saw back in Isaiah 6. And today is interesting in Isaiah chapter 42. We'll look at it in a moment. But before we go any further, remember that you can get the Bible guide, and the Bible guide is something that is print form to help you go through the Bible with us. And it can be sent to you if you write to us and send an offering in any amount to the U.S. or Canadian address. If you're in another country, write to the Canadian address. But also, you can go to www.BibleDiscoveryTV.com. BibleDiscoveryTV.com. When you give there, it takes you right to the beautiful PDF files. Very important. As we focus on this in the steps of faith, I realize that we're talking about the servant of the Lord. Now, the servant of the Lord is amazing. We're talking about Messiah. And I believe Messiah to be, and not only I, but many people, many millions of people, believe that the servant of the Lord is Jesus Christ. When we read from Isaiah chapter 42 to 43, we keep up going through the Bible, which is important as we do that this year. But we're going to focus on Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 to 13. So as we do that, we understand what God is saying to us, and here is what the Bible says, beginning with the first four verses. Behold, that means take note. Behold, my servant whom I uphold, my elect one, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the Gentiles. He will not cry out, nor raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoking flax he will not quench. He will bring forth justice for truth. Justice for truth. That's very important to remember that. He will not fail nor be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth. And the coastlands shall wait for his law. That's very important. And as we see this, we understand, as we look at history, that Jesus Christ brings justice to the Gentiles, the non-Jewish folks. Mankind attempted it, but cannot accomplish it without the help of the Holy Spirit. Now, justice is not something that we regularly see in our governments every day. No, it's not. It is something we have to work for and something we seek God for, something we come to Jesus Christ and ask Him for. He is the one that brings justice. He is the one who brings this. Very important as we understand this. So we go back to the scripture and we learn in chapter 42, verses 5 through 9, thus says the God, the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread forth the earth and that which comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it and spirit to those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness and hold your hand. I keep you and give you as a covenant to the people, as a light to the Gentiles, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from prison, and those who sit in darkness from the prison house. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to carved images. Behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Now, this is amazing because we look at this. The Lord created and stretched out the heavens. That's what He did. And when we replace the idea from God's word, we participate or perpetuate a lie. And we must be set free from our own thoughts. And our own thoughts tell us many things. That's what cosmology does. Cosmology is something that we dream up how it was created and we come up with the idea. The Bible tells us how God did it. He stretched out the heavens. God laid the heavens out. He created the earth. He created the heavens. It is God. He is the creator. He is the one. And as we begin to understand how God did this, it becomes important to us to realize it and to think about it. Now we go on, of course, to the last couple of verses. And this is verse 10. It says, "Sing to the Lord a new song, and His praise from the ends of the earth. You who go down to the sea, and all that is in it, you coastlands, and you inhabitants of them. Let the wilderness and its cities lift up their voice, and the villages that Kedar inhabits, let them, inhabitants of Selah, sing. Let them shout aloud from the top of the mountains. Let them give glory to the Lord and declare His praise in the coastlands. For the Lord shall go forth like a mighty man. He shall stir up His zeal like a man of war. He shall cry out, yes, shout aloud. He shall prevail against His enemies." Now, this is a stunning thing. We realize that God will prevail against His enemies. It doesn't matter what we think, because in the end, God establishes Himself as the Lord of lords and the host of hosts in heavens. And this is what we have to understand. Those of us who believe in a creation of the universe, those of us who understand God and who realize what He did, we need to understand that the Lord will tell us at the end of time. He will tell the truth about everything, because truth is very much a part of justice. We not only seek justice from God, but we seek truth from God too. And He tells us the truth, and all the theories that everybody's come up with will be down in the dust and gone. Because the truth about the creation of the universe and the truth about all of this will be revealed in the end of time. God is going to reveal Himself, and He's going to do it in absolute truth.
In the books of 2 Kings, 2 Chronicles, and Isaiah, it is recorded that King Hezekiah rid the land of Judah from high places, sacred pillars, and Asherah poles. Right now, you and I are going to conduct a study on what these things actually were.
Many of the biblical prophets denounced ancient Israel and Judah for their degradation of true worship, either an all-out rejection of the command to worship only God, or a perverse intermingling of the worship of God with the practices of other nations. A common evaluation of a king in the biblical books of Kings and Chronicles was whether or not the king's heart was fully devoted to God. One of the key demonstrations of this was if the king took down the high places in the land. Most did not. Not much explanation is given about these high places other than that they were places of worship, sanctuaries, and complexes used during the time of the kings for deviant worship. The first example of a king of Israel building high places is King Solomon, whom we are told built high places to the gods of the Moabites and Ammonites on a hill across from Jerusalem. Following his lead, the new king of the north, Jeroboam, built two shrine cities, Bethel and Dan, for northern Israel. The ancient cultic city of Dan today has been excavated, and its royal high place seems to be a good example of these ancient Israelite high places. The idols were long gone, but what did remain for archaeologists to find was a huge open-air platform, 60 feet across, an ancient high place complete with bone fragments from sacrifices, altars, cultic utensils, and standing stones or sacred pillars. Through the evaluation and study of the kinds and types of animal bones found at Dan, it appears as though at this city the deviant Israelites still stuck to a priestly code somewhat in line with Israelite laws for sacrificing found in the Torah. This suggests that they were trying to mix their cultural identity while worshiping whatever and however they wanted. Both this kind of pseudo-priestly worship, as well as all-out pagan worship, are both mentioned in the Bible, and now are evidenced in history.
This month, we are making it possible for you to own your own copy of Ryan Hembree's Studies into Space, a DVD collection of over 30 of Ryan's Quick Study television segments. The DVD is entitled Cosmic Mysteries, Discovering a Universe by Design, Segment Library, Volume 1. In this first volume, Ryan explores astronomical discoveries from a biblical perspective. Have you ever wondered if the stars can help us understand certain events in the Bible, or how they play a part in the creation evolution debate? Ryan has wondered and investigated. Now his studies are available on more than just the daily program. Our hope is that these segments will be an encouragement to your faith and a way for you to dig deeper into your studies of the Bible. To get your copy, call or write us with a suggested donation of $25 or more, and be sure to ask for your copy of Cosmic Mysteries, Discovering a Universe by Design.
Thank you for staying with us here on Quick Study Television. Let me tell you that next time on the Quick Study program, I'm going to be talking about this. In fact, many Jews and Gentiles will choose to serve God. And we'll talk about what that means and why coming up next time on Quick Study Television. Right now, Ryan is here. Ryan?
Well, I'm pumped because today I'm interviewing a nuclear physicist. Dr. Jim Mason works for Creation Ministries International, and I recently had the chance to sit down with him and ask him a few questions. So in today's interview, I ask him about some of the recent discoveries in physics and how they affect the creation-evolution debate.
Well, there's in the recent past, there's been some really interesting discoveries made that impact upon this creation-evolution debate from a sort of physics perspective. One is the observation that decay rates, radioactive decay rates, actually vary with time. They found this for a number of isotopes, in particular cobalt-60, which is an interesting one because it's one I used to use in my graduate days as a calibration tool, because we knew it has a single gamma ray frequency, so we used it as a calibration tool. But it's been found that the decay rate of cobalt-60 actually varies by, I think it's about 2% on an annual basis. It's somehow related to the Earth-Sun distance and or the rotational rate of the Sun. They don't know why, but it does vary. So this brings up the possibility that it may have varied quite considerably in the past, which is one of the things that the rate group found when they were looking at radio halos, for example, and zircon, and the uranium and zircon. So that's one of the things. Another thing is some recent reports at a conference that they found carbon-14 in dinosaur bones. And carbon-14, of course, if the whole world was made of carbon-14, it would decay entirely in less than a million years. And dinosaur bones are supposedly 65 million years old, so this does not compute. And in fact, the machines that they use to do the radiocarbon dating have a sensitivity that limits them to detecting carbon from things that are less than 90,000 years old. So this radiocarbon in dinosaur bones is indicating that the dinosaur bones are clearly less than the stated 65 million years old, and only maybe a few thousand years old. And another thing that's pretty interesting that's been up recently in the news, there was a claim made back in March that scientists using some apparatus in the South Pole had detected evidence of gravity waves through looking at the polarization of cosmic microwave background radiation. And this polarization, what they found, they claimed, was proof of the Big Bang. But since that time, there's been a lot of back and forth in the secular journals, in fact, and it's now apparently, when they actually finally published, this was a press release that they put out before, when they finally published the article in the journal, they included a comment that said, the evidence is could be explained simply by the polarization produced by local dust. So it's gone from the, if you like, the smoking gun for the Big Bang to, you know, maybe totally irrelevant information.
You know, it's interesting that these discoveries Dr. Mason has pointed out have really challenged the evolutionary view. One of the things he talked about was how the presence of carbon-14 found in dinosaur bones really challenges the evolutionary age given to them, since carbon-14 decays really fast. Now, Dr. Mason will be back next weekend to talk to us some more about dating methods, so I hope you join us for that.
Very good, Ryan. That's excellent. These are fascinating points. And for July, we featured Ryan. He's done some segments, and we put them together, and they can be used. And what's
into his segment library? It's a segments that are all about the stars, all about space, cosmic mysteries. So,
very good. So stars and space, and get your telescope out if you don't have it. Just order this device. It's good.
Very the DVD.
Important. Yeah, the DVD. Yes, of course.
The segment library.
That's right. The segment library. That's very important. All right. So here's. Here's the website. Go to BibleDiscoveryTV.com. That's on the internet. And you can receive yours and get a hold of yours and give an offering of $25 or more, recommended, or P.O. Box 150, Marysville, Pennsylvania, 15668-0150. Or you can also write to P.O. Box 456, Orangeville, Ontario, L9W5G2. Remember, that's also for people who are overseas or in different nations. Now, remember, you can call us at 724-733-8336 or 519-940-8338.
It is God's work to show himself. It is our work to show others how God changed us. This is important to understand and cultivate. We must let the Lord our God have his way in our life. God is not difficult to please. He calls on us to express our absolute need and desire for his work in us. This is necessary so others can see God's work in our life. Many choose to know God, but they don't follow him. If we say that Jesus Christ is our Lord, we choose to follow Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ is real, and he's alive. And he rose from the dead 2,000 years ago after he allowed himself to be crucified. Why is this important? Because we must make a decision today. And this program wouldn't be complete unless I told you how to do that. You pray and you say to God, Lord, forgive me of my sin, and I desire to make Jesus Christ the Lord of my life now. Do that today and change everything about your life.